Thank you. Good morning, everybody. So this is a bit different for me. Usually I'm talking about feral pig management and, you know, what we can do to improve how we kill more of these animals. And today I'm talking about the people. So, you know, we've heard all morning about how the people are such a key component to this project. And working with Ted Alter and others, I've actually developed and are working on a PhD to test different ways to engage the community. So I want to go through some of that today. And just think about that. I think it's already full. I'm back on. Good. Okay. So is feral pig management a problem? Is the question, I guess. I mean, for years, I just assumed communities wanted to get rid of feral pigs. But, you know, we have to accept that they're a resource out there. We have to respect all the different people's points of view about feral pigs and not just be silly like I was and assume that everybody wanted to get rid of them. And so that was a big challenge for me. You know, how do we engage with communities and make sure we listen and respect all different facets of the community, but then come up with a plan with that community about how we move ahead and how we actually control the animals to a point that community wants. So my aim is to bridge that gap. We've got fantastic researchers out there that work on the biophysical, the ecological, the controlling of feral pigs. We've also got fantastic researchers out there that focus on the human dimension work and how we do the social science to get people to work together. I want to crash those two worlds together. I believe unless we crash them together, we don't get the outcome that we need. We need to bring them both together so that people can learn about the truth and not a lot of the myth that is out there about these feral animals, in this case feral pigs, and what they do and where they go, how far they travel, and actually bring that together with how we motivate landholders. So then we've got the control techniques, we know the ecology, we can dispel the myths, and we can get people to work together. How do we mix that up and bring those worlds together? So the project that I've created overall is across 11 different sites. The PhD part's 4 sites. We've collared over 250 feral pigs across 11 different communities, and we're looking at all of that ecology, working really closely with the Vertebrate Pest Research Unit and also Biosecurity Queensland. We are working with those scientists to pull together the information about the ecology, the control, the movement patterns, so we can help landholders better work on controlling feral pigs. But what I want to talk about today is the human dimension side of it, the people side of it, because we cannot ignore it. For 15 years, I tried to, and it doesn't work. We've got to get these people to work together and bring that together. So I use GPS tracking collars as the vehicle, just as the tool to motivate the community. One of the biggest things that I believed was there's a lot of myth. There's a lot of attitudes, thoughts, beliefs that are out there about where feral pigs move. Of course, they all live in the national park and they travel 30 kilometres every night to eat my crop and then go back to the national park. If it's not a national park, it's a mining company. So, you know, we need to work on those myths and we need to get people to listen and accept and take on board that new information. And that's not me as a researcher standing up there telling them. We found that. The landholders don't necessarily believe that. They believe what their neighbours say. They believe what they get told at the pub over what I say. And so I believe the collars are a really good tool and a good vehicle to engage the community to tell them the truth. So the innovation that I'm testing is different levels of engagement. So on some of my groups, I have what we call really thick engagement. So that's where I work with the community right from the start, build the project with them, take them on each step of the process with me and build the project with them. And then other sites, I do the expert model. So I come in as a researcher and I just do my research that I developed that I then come get permission to implement on their property, and then I take it away. And then other sites, we have just done engagement. So we've just engaged the community and we haven't used any research. And then, of course, there's the status quo. So just to rehash that, these are the six sites as part of the PhD. The blue sites, the top ones in the Arcadia Valley in central Queensland and the bottom blue sites in Moree in New South Wales, they're engagement positive, research positive. That means I'm doing this thick engagement, the Penn State thick engagement style of bringing the community along, and then I'm also using the collars as research. So engagement positive, research positive. The next one's engagement negative, research positive. They're the two yellow sites. What I've done there is not necessarily engaged with the community. I have just been an extension, a research officer. I've just gone out and implemented my research and then come back. The third treatment is engagement positive, research negative. It's what we do as NRM groups all the time. We try to engage with the community with no research necessarily. So that's what I did there, just tried to engage, motivate the community without the collar research. And then, of course, I needed a control site. So no engagement, no research, which is just the status quo. It was quite an experience. I mean, this is the Arcadia Valley. What you're seeing up there is where the pigs moved. We heard before from the keynotes about the importance of trust, the importance of relationships. This map I have to show four or five times whenever I show it to those landholders, because it just brings out more and more information. Different pigs come and go. This is over a three-year period. The pigs move across the country, dispelling a whole heap of those myths. The two national parks on either side, the pigs don't really go into it. There's nothing to eat there. There's a whole heap of crop in the middle of that country. They all thought that the pigs would be attracted to that crop, but they're not. There's a whole heap of things come out of this extension tool that tell the landholders the truth that is not me telling them what to do. So it's allowing them to build their own beliefs. So they build their own trust between each other. They build the trust between me and them, and then the networks that they can use to implement that. So my research objectives. Overall, I'm hoping to look at, will community-based research increase collective action? So will it increase people to participate in coordinated control? I have broken that community-based research down, and I'm looking at how I can break it into things that I can test with the hypotheses. So I'm saying collective action is a function of knowledge, attitudes, trust, and the networks. So they're really important, those four things. So all of my hypotheses are built around those. So what is the knowledge that landholders have? Where do they get that from? Do they listen to us as researchers? Do they listen to the pub talk? Do they listen to their neighbours? What's their attitude of who is responsible for control? How do the control methods work? How do they implement those? What's their trust between each other and their neighbours? And their trust with me as a researcher, and also their networks. So the human dimension methods. I've looked at the attitude surveys. I've done surveys pre and post each of those sites we looked at. So I've conducted surveys testing those hypotheses before we implement the project and then after we implement the project. Then most importantly, I can test those hypotheses across those different treatment sites. So we've got 201 surveys complete, and now we are putting them into the system to analyse those. We're also using key informant interviews. We've got 21 participants across all the six sites where we have asked key in-depth questions looking at the most significant change that those landholders have experienced through being part of the project in each of those different treatment sites, and we are analysing those as well. And also the community profiles. So we need to know the background of that community. We need to know what drives them, what their beliefs are, when they were formed, what the land use is, all of those types of things. And essentially, it's been quite an experience. Stay tuned for the actual results. They're all being crunched at the moment. I'm just going to be like everyone else and blame COVID that we couldn't get to all of those groups to get all that data back. So I can't present it all today. But just some overarching themes that I wanted to touch on. Knowledge, the knowledge that landholders have about feral pigs and their movements, The map that's on the screen now is showing a boar and a sow and where they actually move and how small their home range is. And the knowledge that landholders have is often respectfully based on belief, which is not always correct. And so this is how we've brought that back. Landholders prefer to listen to their neighbours than they do to listen to me as a researcher. And that come from the pre and the post interviews, no matter what the treatment site was. So we need to think and rethink about how we give landholders knowledge that they will listen to and accept. Maybe we need to tell their neighbours and go to the pub more and talk to them. I don't know. Their attitudes towards who is responsible for feral pig control. I work for an NRM group. We do all we can to motivate people to work together. We give them incentives. We try to get them to work together. I've worked with LLSs. I've worked with mining companies, other NRM groups. All of them are looking to incentivize landholders to do this work. The problem with that is it can develop an attitude that it's not the landholder's responsibility and it's not their problem. So therefore, hey, Darren, your feral pigs are back. When are you going to get me another grant to control them? So we need to think about that. We need to think about the attitudes and what information we give to change those attitudes. Trust. I believe trust is the biggest one. Within the community, there are all sorts of trust issues that we probably can't work with a whole lot, but the trust that they have with us as researchers or with us as extension officers is just really important. And I believe with the engagement positive and research positive model that Penn State's developed with me, it's worked really well. We have developed that trust and we have been able to build that to the point that we build new projects on after we finish these ones because they trust and respect us, we trust and respect them, everybody's equal, we build the projects together. The last one's the networks. Of course, the networks are really important. You know, we have to have good networks, not just with the landholders, with national parks, with LLS, with mining companies, with the railway track that runs through there, with everybody there, the nil tenure approach. You know, we need to make sure that everybody is included and involved. And you know, just to finish up, I look forward to bringing the results of the survey and the key informant interviews. And stay tuned for that. And also, please stay tuned for the actual biophysical findings of where these 250 pigs have moved and what their resource selections are based on these projects at the next conference. Thank you.
For an excellent talk. Are there any questions? There's one from Bruce Christie. Going to the pub and talking to neighbours, you've won me. There you go. No impact.
Excellent.
I had a question. You spoke about networks and how do you connect? How do you establish those networks between, and say, a mining company, and particularly for once you're not there anymore? Any reflections on that?
A lot of reflections on that. The network thing, I think, is really important. Especially the mining company example, the mining companies like to work with us because we engage the community and then the mining company can come and give their message. So we get the community together because of something interesting, and that's the collars. And I think building that network to go deeper to the core of that is making sure we listen and respect what the landholders want to get out of that. I can't just go to the landholders and say, here's a project. Let's do this project. If I build that project with them and then bring all of the different networks in that are relevant to that project, I think their ownership is a lot higher. So therefore, we have a much greater success rate. And therefore, when we finish and move away, a good example is the Arcadia Valley one that I showed. They are now going to move in and do cats and dogs as well because they're working together, they've built their networks with the community and with the relevant researchers, and now they can move ahead and do that work.
Excellent. Thank you, Darren.